All right, so thank you so much. And there is interpretation in English and in Spanish. My name is David Berger. I'm an advisor with IGUIA, the International Work Group for Indigenous Affairs, and I will be your moderator for today. And I am so privileged to join this amazing panel. As I was mentioning, we're going to try and give two of our panelists a little bit more time to make it to the room. So we'll start with a short video in English about the Indigenous Navigator to give you a little bit of context to today's discussion. So we'll play that now.
There are 5,000 different Indigenous peoples worldwide, comprising 476 million individuals in 90 countries. All Indigenous communities are culturally distinct, but we face many of the same human rights challenges. Across the globe, we experience discrimination, marginalization, and exclusion from political processes and decision-making that affect our lives. Our rights to lands, territories, and natural resources are often not respected. This severely impacts our livelihoods, food security, and well-being. We are also 3 times more likely than other people to live in extreme poverty, making us more vulnerable to the impact of climate change and to the devastating effects of COVID-19. It is critical to document and raise awareness about our human rights situation. That's why the Indigenous Navigator was created, to provide a set of tools to monitor the recognition and implementation of our rights worldwide. The Indigenous Navigator is developed by a number of Indigenous peoples and human rights organizations. The online tools and resources help Indigenous communities to collect data on the community and the national situation. The tools cover essential thematic areas. These include rights to self-determination, lands, territories, and resources, as well as health and education. Monitoring of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People and other human rights and labor instruments are built into the tools. And so are all the Sustainable Development Goals related to Indigenous people's rights. Thereby, the Indigenous Navigator can be used to monitor both the most important human rights instruments and the Sustainable Development Goals. The collected data is presented in comprehensive national and community reports and can be visualized, explored, and compared in our online portal. By documenting and reporting our own situations, we can enhance our access to justice and development and help document the situation of Indigenous peoples globally. Indigenous communities can use the data to advocate for their rights at the local, national, and international level. It can also help to hold states accountable by monitoring their compliance with or failure to meet human rights obligations with regards to Indigenous peoples. Many Indigenous communities have already benefited from the Indigenous Navigator's tools. One of these is Okani, a community-based Indigenous organization located in Cameroon. Using the tool to collect data at the community level, Okani was able to record the number of community members who don't have birth certificates and national identity cards. Without these documents, they are unable to vote, apply for jobs, or move freely around the country. This data provided Okani with important advocacy materials, which helped them to take action. In this way, the Indigenous Navigator can support and strengthen the self-determined governance and empower us to claim our rights. For more information, go online at indigenousnavigator.org.
Drinking warm water before bed could help reset blood sugar.
Well, as we know, drinking warm water can be very helpful. And thank you to YouTube for that lovely reminder. I'm very glad to share, of course, that we now have our remaining 2 panelists and we're ready to begin the event. So I'd like to welcome you to this event on the Indigenous Navigator. We have a number of speakers with us today that represent Indigenous peoples who have been working with the Indigenous Navigator from different sociocultural regions around the world. The title of this event and the theme of this event is to provide a platform for exploring the effective realization of self-determination through the exercise of autonomy, respect for customary law, and the strengthening of Indigenous institutions. And it includes a presentation of a tool which was designed by and with indigenous peoples to collect data on their situation and on their rights. So again, my name is David Berger. For those who are just joining us, I will be your moderator. We have interpretation in English and Spanish. You can use the earpieces in order to access that and the channels. And with that, I would like to introduce our first speaker who will give us the opening remark, who is Ms. Joji Carino. She is the convener of the Indigenous Navigator Consortium and a staunch human rights defender from the Philippines. Please, Joji.
Thanks very much, David.
Thank
you. Welcome all of us to this side event. I hope that this will provide a chance for us to learn more about the indigenous navigator, but also to be working together in the future in the use of our tools. So we have a short video that was shown, but why was this indigenous navigator really brought together? So we had more than 20 years of engagement with the UN. Get the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples adopted by the General Assembly. So the question now is, how does this now help us, now that we have the UN Declaration? And of course, part of getting this declaration really for each of us, and also for our governments to understand their accountabilities, and to actually let them implement their obligations. We need tools, and we need the monitoring of the implementation and realization of these rights. And the Indigenous Navigator was designed precisely to help us do that in our communities, but also in our engagement with governments, and in all of the processes where we have to provide evidence about what is actually happening in our communities. So, because the theme of the permanent forum is self-determination. Self-determination is foundational right. It's of course related to how we ourselves perform, strengthen ourselves, and actually exercise and show our own self-determination, right? And in many statements by indigenous peoples, we have said that self-determination and sustainable development are two sides of the same coin. Yeah? Because unless we have the foundation of self-determination, how will we be able to carry out all of our own visions for sustainable development, but also demand the support from states to carry this out? So those two dimensions, which are so important, are covered by the Indigenous Navigator, both by monitoring the declaration, but also the sustainable development goals. And because we are here now on the 10th anniversary of the World Conference on Indigenous Peoples, governments in reviewing these commitments and implementation made further specific commitments and identification of priorities that they will carry out in the countries together with us. And so, again, also the Indigenous Navigator looks at the implementation of the outcomes of the World Conference on Indigenous Peoples. So, indeed, Indigenous organizations and support organizations came together to develop this tool, and it's now being used in presently more than 30 countries, and evidence coming from over 300 communities. So we hope that in this, this number will grow, because this is indeed a tool to serve us. So I'll talk a little bit very briefly about the tool. Because it is a human rights monitoring tool, it is founded on the very solid framework of the international human rights instruments that states sign up to, and which in the development of human rights, the rights holders have also been helping the articulation of these rights. So of course, the core human rights documents and the labor documents, but also the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. But what is, I think, incredible and nice about this important time is implementation. It's that rather than just understanding these rights in a general legal articulation, what the indigenous navigator does is to actually use these tools and the definition of these rights with communities for them to say, okay, the meaning of that right for me is this, like what was said in Cameroon. What is the meaning of your right to participation or citizenship when what we have found out is you don't have any citizenship papers? And when this was revealed in the indigenous navigator, this was used to actually get those papers and to advance the recognition within the countries. Right. So I think through our presenters, these rights, which have core attributes, like self-determination, has the attributes of respect to our rights, to recognition of our distinct identities, customary law, to free prior informed consent. These core attributes are then translated into questions or indicators. And these are the questions which are then used in the national and community surveys. I won't say much more about the methodologies because it's best to hear directly from our speakers about how they have used these tools and how it has helped them in their own experiences. Thank you very much again for coming. Let's learn together.
Thank you very much, Jyoti, for giving us this context as well as for unpacking just what exactly the Indigenous Navigator is and how it can be used by communities in order to assert their rights, but also to create evidence-based documentation of the real situation on the ground that these communities face every day. I'd like to introduce our second speaker, who is Toribia Lero Quispe. She's an Indigenous woman from the Sura Nation in Bolivia. She's an activist and defender of Indigenous people's rights and the rights of women and democracy, and she's a parliamentarian of Bolivia. So, Toribia, please, the floor is yours, and please press the button to speak. Yes, perfect. And for those who need the translation, she will be speaking in Spanish.
Muy buenas tardes, nuevamente. Agradecer a Udía por haberme permitido nuevamente estar presente en esta presentación de lo que es el navegador indígena. No solamente eso, también quiero decir que Udía en Bolivia apoya el programa de las crías indígenas en los campos de los cianos, recientemente de Cristina Camona, y los centros indígenas de los cianos. Es un orgullo tener en país donde tiene que tener oportunidad de acceder a la educación general. El navegador indígena de Bolivia fue aplicado en el marco del diseño internacional, del diseño de los, a los 10 años de haberse cumplido los derechos de los pueblos civiles, de la declaración de las Naciones Unidas sobre los pueblos civiles, 10 años de haber transcurrido. Y entonces la navegador indígena ha significado un proyecto que consistía en elaborar un diagnóstico, trabajar un diagnóstico sobre la situación, el estado de situación del pueblo indígena. Mi pueblo, Cajamarca, Tapacarico, la parte está ubicada en la región andina, fue beneficiario de este proyecto. Durante muchos meses trabajamos este diagnóstico y dio resultado, por ejemplo, como dato, 5 datos muy importantes de todo lo que son los derechos. Uno, la pérdida de la lengua materna, idioma aymara y quechua. El 99% de la niñez y su juventud no sabía hablar, sino que no hablar. El segundo dato nos da el tema de la educación, el acceso a una educación de calidad. No hay guarderías infantiles. La educación, a pesar de que la Constitución reconoce la educación intercultural bilingüe, continúa impartiéndose en un solo idioma, que es el español. También salió como otro dato el tema de la consulta. El pueblo indígena no conoce el derecho a la consulta, entonces difícilmente puede exigir al Estado que se realice consulta para temas de desarrollo o aprobación de normativas en el país. El cuarto tema salió el tema de bajos niveles de producción. El pueblo está devastado por el cambio climático, sequías, escasez de agua, migraciones, y entonces hay bajísimos niveles de producción y también por los otros, porque el cambio climático ha afectado muchísimo y la escasez de tierra, porque la población crece y no es inactiva. También la juventud, no hay trabajo para la juventud, los jóvenes no han dejado a sus papás, entonces el único horizonte que tienen es salir a las ciudades en busca de mejores condiciones de vida. Pero estos datos, ¿cómo se aplican? El pueblo, al conocer estos datos, realiza un gran evento, una gran asamblea, y conoce los datos y toma una decisión, cómo se dan las brechas en uno de esos datos, y decide trabajar el tema de la recuperación de las lenguas, y el otro tema, mejorar los niveles económicos de la comunidad, porque era la producción. Y es en ese marco que se aprobó un proyecto para hacer frente a esto, trabajar esos dos datos, que ha sido muy importante, porque en ese proceso no solamente se ha trabajado la implementación del proyecto como tal, sino el proyecto de navegador ha empoderado, fortalecido el autogobierno, el control territorial, la defensa del territorio, porque es una región amenazada por actividad minera. El pueblo, después de conocer la declaración de las naciones sobre los derechos de los pueblos indígenas, ejercita la práctica del derecho a la justicia, de la administración de la justicia propia, pero el Estado le dice, tu justicia no sirve, tienes que acudir a la justicia ordinaria. Y también le dice, tu territorio no sirve, porque es la actividad minera que da dinero, regalías, impuestos, en cambio el territorio indígena no te hace nada. Entonces, pero todo esto también se vuelve positivo porque luego empieza a analizar, reflexionar y decide entender batalla legal, y recientemente se logra una resolución de un órgano ejecutivo que le da esa opción de que sí, ahora puede el pueblo ejercitar el derecho a la consulta para el consentimiento. Entonces, navegador indígena como datos no simplemente es para que esté ahí, sino que sirvió muchísimo para la defensa del autogobierno y también del derecho. Pero quiero también decirles que en Bolivia tenemos una nueva constitución política del Estado plurinacional del 2009. Reconoce el derecho a la libre determinación, al territorio ancestral, al pluralismo jurídico, a la protección de los territorios, a los indígenas. Pero hay una fórmula que dice todos estos derechos se ejercitarán en el marco de una ley. Entonces, es la ley la que se elabora de manera anticonstitucional, y son varias leyes, y son esas leyes que nos enfrentan pueblos indígenas y un supuesto gobierno de tensión. Por haber exigido el cumplimiento del derecho a la consulta, los pueblos indígenas de una gran marcha nacional como fue la octava marcha en defensa de un territorio indígena, parque nacional, y Siboro Secure, fue cruel y brutalmente golpeado, reprimido por el gobierno. Y después, intervenido, asaltado las dos principales organizaciones como la CONAMAP y la CIDOR. Después, nos confiscaron un fondo indígena que habíamos luchado los pueblos indígenas por muchos años, pero el gobierno nos quita y se lo entrega a las alcaldías. Persigue dirigentes, líderes, defensores indígenas, nos dice que somos de la derecha, somos de Indepatria, que somos enemigos de un gobierno indígena, supuestamente, y nos acalla y no tenemos más voz. Y continúa la situación, ¿no? Porque las leyes de las que les hablo es la ley de autonomía. Y la ley de autonomías ya te dice qué es lo que vas a hacer. Ahí están los mandatos, lo que vas a hacer en una autonomía indígena, entonces no hay indeterminación. Y se convierte en un largo proceso administrativo y burocrático. La ley de deslinde jurisdiccional nos dice solamente ustedes pueden resolver casos así, chiquitos, los casos grandes, ¿no? La ley minera que nos dice que el actor minero ha llegado antes que nosotros al territorio. El derecho preconstituido del actor minero. Y siguen las represiones, porque después aprueba un sinfín de leyes para incendiar los bosques, para echar mercurio a los ríos amazónicos, para el avasallamiento de tierras, para que los pueblos indígenas en situación de contacto inicial o pueblos no contactados estén totalmente alejados del Estado. Y con eso les digo, ayer yo escuché al segundo mandatario del país hablar mucho de los pueblos indígenas y la gente le ovaciona, pero no hay nada de autocrítica. ¿Saben por qué? Porque ese gobierno, el gobierno del vicepresidente que estuvo aquí, son 18 años de gobierno. Y en esos 18 años ha aprobado todas esas leyes nefastas. Entonces, tiene que haber autocrítica, pero positiva. Porque nuestros pueblos, los hombres, mujeres, niñas y niños en particular, tienen el cuerpo, la sangre contaminada con mercurio, niveles altísimos. Y no lo digo yo, lo dice el relator especial sobre el mercurio. Hay muchísima violación, vulneración de derechos de los pueblos indígenas. No lo digo yo, incluso la autonomía autogobierno lo dice la CIDEA, la Convención Interamericana para los Derechos Humanos. Hay mucho que hacer a los derechos humanos, más aún contra pueblos indígenas. Por eso ayer yo comencé señalando 200 mineros enfrentándose a 6 mujeres indígenas que solamente reclamaban el derecho a su territorio, de donde fuera el derecho. Entonces, en esas condiciones, ¿cómo podemos disfrutar el derecho a la libre determinación? En esas condiciones, ¿cómo podemos hablar de dejar, de heredar un futuro para nuestras generaciones? Por eso les pido a ustedes que son aliados, solidarios con la causa indígena, acompañen a todos los pueblos indígenas, acompañen la causa de Bolivia, informen, hagan seguimiento, porque de eso se trata la alianza, las redes y estas solidaridades. Y también yo agradezco muchísimo a la Federación Indígena que sí nos ha dado fortaleza seguir con ustedes. Que nos acompañen, porque esos datos verdaderamente se siguieron no para defender a un movimiento penalista, no, sino simplemente para generar brechas de desigualdad, para decir todo lo que se aprueba aquí en estas Naciones Unidas, en este foro que se habla, y uno va muy fortalecido allá, dice, mira las Naciones Unidas donde se aprobó en 1979 la declaración. Y ahora tenemos que ejercitar, solamente pedimos de eso. Y por eso, nuevamente, muchas gracias por escucharme. Y no quiero dejar de decir, los hermanos, que dicen, el pueblo de Lomelío en Santa Cruz, el pueblo indígena de Lomelío en Santa Cruz, es 15 años que está peregrinando para lograr una autonomía indígena. El pueblo de Huacaya ha peregrinado 14 años para lograr una autonomía indígena, pero que ni siquiera con libre determinación, simplemente se nos accede. Pues hay que avanzar, ¿no? Y eso es la autocrítica, hay que avanzar y avanzar, porque en algún momento, con ese avance, con esa fortaleza, sí habremos cerrado esas brechas de desigualdad, habremos avanzado y también combatido en contra del colonialismo, habremos avanzado con la descolonización y hasta la construcción de un Estado comunitario.
Thank you so much, Rubia, for these comments, for explaining about how the Indigenous Navigator is one of many tools to really achieve and to respect Indigenous people's rights, but also to achieve this dream of self-determination. And thank you for sharing about the struggles that have faced your people and community and the powerful work that you have done and how it is a work of many people joined together in order to bring that just future. So thank you so much for these comments. I'd like to turn the floor now to Chansa to speak about the situation in Tanzania. Eli is a member of FINGO's Forum, and he has been working in implementation of the Indigenous Navigator, so it's my pleasure to turn the floor over to him.
Thank you, Andy. Well, my name is Chansa. An alternate to call go by the name Chansa. Council with us finding. I will talk in terms of questionnaires. And my number one question, which I've been asking myself, is why has David decided to put to have me sit in front of this person? Maybe you have an answer with that. So, question number one, I'll say, how do you work? How do you achieve your advocacy? How do you meet your goals in a situation and the state and the nation, in a nation which is really, which really feels being annoyed by just seeing? And the answer would be, question number one. This has been a soft approach to having us achieve our goals. You know, sometimes when the government is so reluctant, when you have to conduct a second study and you tell them, and they have to impose a lot of laws on you, who are you, why do you have to do this kind of research, for what purpose, what is the benefit in the community, what is the benefit to the states, is it sensitive to matters of national security, all those kind of questions, you know, just to put a stop to make you halt your process of achieving and realizing your goals for advocating the rights of indigenous peoples. Now, Tanzania does not recognize indigenous peoples to date. They are still battling around, and they would rather say and have a different synonym, a nickname, or say vulnerable groups, vulnerable populations. They'll just come up with a different name so that they shy away from responsibilities, because they understand they have to be liable for whatsoever that, and address historical injustice when it comes to that. But with Indigenous Navigator, we have been able to involve the governments in our advocacy. They don't like it, but they have to, because we tell them this is a service delivery project, and we would like to go do an assessment and see what the community is in need of. Now, if you take a look at the questionnaire that this tool has developed, you realize it's so deep. Sometimes they don't like you asking the questions, but hey, okay, so they want to do something here, so let me just, let me abstain myself from doing anything, and let's wait what comes out. Later on, of course, it turns out to be better, but already we have all the data that we need, and we can use it for advocacy. For instance, in places like in Selangiro, you get to ask a lot of questions. One of the questions, apart from the mortality rate or child death rate, and then you get to ask about their cultural aspect, their language, and then as the answer, you get to realize how many do have are able to vote, how many are not registered, how many are having their rights dispossessed just by being indigenous. So this has been a very wonderful tool to make us and enable us to penetrate deeply into the communities to having whatsoever that we will desire for advocacy. Question number two would be, how do you climb the high ladders? And I'll say it through IN, Indigenous Navigator. Often at times we have been trying to get an avenue with the high ranks, the likes of the president or the vice president or the prime minister or whosoever that might be in command up the chain of this, the decision-making chain on top of them. But it has been really different, even though we tried different avenues and different ways and modalities, we still believe maybe our messages are allowed out there and being heard. But hey, since we don't have the feedback, we have still to try different mechanisms. The Indigenous Navigator has been one of a methodology, we'll say, that enabled us to do so, because we were also able to seek an avenue with advisors from the President's office under the pretext of Indigenous Navigator projects, and that was possible. So, but we still don't know what was the President told, what we wish. Was she informed about everything, but at least we were able then to submit our recommendations on land rights, on our identity, our identification, and as and peace in the country, even though they do not want to do so. The closest we were to being identified was during the constitutional reform process a couple of years ago, 10 right now. But again, even though they avoided the name Indigenous Peoples, they had our consents and put them in the draft constitution. But still, since we never went for a referendum, the voting process for the new constitution, the proposed constitution, is we still have a fight and about to carry on. But this has been able to open doors, and they are willing to listen when they believe we are not there to cause chaos. Sometimes they think our names or our surnames are violence. So, and we normally call them violence. So, what's your name? My name is Eddie Chancellor. Okay, so you are Eddie Violence. But with Indigenous Navigator, some doors are open, but we are still not very happy because we want to see the end of the door along the corridors. And question number four, how does the community know that they are on the same page that is right for them? How do they know that they are on the right track? So we feel Indigenous Navigator Project, because there is the sense, the essence of community-driven project. In different communities where we have implemented this project, we are currently implementing them in four districts, that is Wangido, that is Mburu, Kiteto, and Simanjiro. Don't worry, we can talk about that later. But in every place, whereas after looking out in the community, you would need to do a land advocacy, but then there's hunger, they are dying, and their priority will be to survive first, so that they keep on the fight. This has been able, through the questionnaire, we have been able to identify what is the gap in the community, in any specific community, and what is their recommendation thereof, and henceforth, what can be done. So everything that is being done are community driven. Even though you might be tempted to say, I think we have to do something, but they have another aspect in mind. I think that is really important because it's making them know if they are on the same track and they respect their need, because that is number one. Apart from saying, I think we have to do this and that, it's more of a, so this is what you say and you're going to do. And communities have come up with that, they came up with different propositions. Some will say we need a well, we need a hospital, we need a school, we need a nursery school, and these, you'll understand that advocating from the ground up is really necessary for self-determination. When you really touch the young ones, and when they are really informed, when their language is preserved, this is the baseline of having a strong community that can defend for itself. And all of this has been really possible through the presence and of our Indigenous Project.
Thank you so much. And thank you for sharing this experience in Tanzania, and particularly for unpacking what it really means to the communities, and unpacking that it's community driven, that it's led by the communities to decide what they do with this data and how they own and control this data, despite all of the other challenges. It comes back to that principle that it's Indigenous-led, and it's their self-determination, and particularly this link to the youth. It's now my privilege to introduce Mane from SIPO, the Cambodia Indigenous Peoples Organization. Yun Mane is an Indigenous Bunong from Manupiri in Northeast Cambodia. She's a staunch Indigenous Peoples rights defender, and it's my pleasure to give the floor to you, Mane.
Thank you, Dave, and good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to be here and for your support with the people as well as organizing this event together with AIPC, Chapter Bar, ICP, DHIO, and also thanks to the European Union that funded to our Indigenous Navigator as well as for this important time event. So I also thank to David for your allowing to sharing about the building and sustaining the indigenous institution. And in relation to this topic, first of all, I would like to remind that based on our navigator data findings from our target indigenous community, it reminds us and shows that our indigenous institution is not new, it is permanent institution that already exists in our community, in our territory, land and resources. And this is very much connected to the land territory when we are talking about the indigenous institution. And as we able, everyone know that this is one of our key identities. That is this with our traditional custom, leadership structure, with our own political, economic, and social structure, as well as with our own value and knowledge system, with our self-government in sustainable practice. And also, where we believe that this institution is the birth, to give birth to us, with our own distinct social culture and economy. Especially, it's also the place where you are with a peaceful, healthy, and dignity. This is very clear based on our navigator data findings that have been documented. So it is the evidence for us, because before we never documented all this. When we come to the discussion or dialogue with the national government, even in the court, they always declare that we are the illegal community or illegal institution, because they asking where is our evidence, where is the proof of document to show that you are the indigenous community or institution. In the context of Cambodia, when we're talking about the indigenous community, it is also the indigenous institution. And also through our indigenous data and navigator data, but also showing the needs and aspirations of our indigenous community in order to building and sustaining of our community institution, we need to think about strengthening our own existing value, knowledge and system of the self-government. This is the most important. Through our knowledge and value, and also to acknowledge our self-determination over our traditional collective leadership. In Cambodian, we call traditional authority, where they are knowledgeable, with existing how we are dealing, harmonize our community member in our existence until today. Especially, we have been play very critical role and responsibility in decision making in sustaining the land, territory, and resource until today. Without those, you cannot see the forest, you cannot see any tree or any wild animal until today. We need to acknowledge that, and that really show us the evidence, to prove when we are talking with the private sector, with the government, when they are accused that we are the one violated to the state land, to the company land. So, also based on our data, it's showing that
the government and private sector should be respected our right to be free, and then we will more, exercise our right. And the government should not adopt any law, policy, procedure to discriminate our right to land and territory and resources, which really directly affect to destroy our own indigenous institutions. So when they destroy the land, territory, and resources, it means they are destroying our institution as well. Yeah. So it is very important and critical that, especially the funder, that I would like to call for attention also to convert their commitment from here, from the global, from their head office, to concrete action at the national and community level to our indigenous institutions at the ground level, so that we are able to access the right finance mechanism to our indigenous institutions, so that we can play more direction, protection, our land, territory, resource, and institution. Especially, with the forest, biodiversity, for our community, for all the nation. Yeah. And the funding also should be based on our institution's need and priority. That allows us, to strengthen our social, cultural, political, value system and sound governance. Especially the funding should be also provide us the core funding with flexibility, simplify the procedure, process, allow us to play more critical roles to acting, protecting those results, and especially to have more energy to think about our solution strategy. And also I would like to call for the government and private sector to be, strengthening cooperation partnership in Eagle and Moshore, God-fed with the respect and option the pre-prior informed consent to be adopted in any situation that affected our indigenous institution at the ground level. So my last, not least, the key message to all of us. If we want to sustain our indigenous institution in the long term, we all need to sustain our existing traditional leadership system structure of self-governance in political, economic, social over our land, territory, and resources. Through documenting and creating the data system of our institution system and use as a tool to advocacy and as an evidence for recognize and respect our rights. Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mane, for these comments and particularly for this focus on indigenous institutions and the use of a tool like the Indigenous Navigator to help support documentation of that evidence that donors and duty bearers can understand and digest. But this reiteration of how strong indigenous institutions are and the fact that these have existed for centuries and centuries and yet are not being acknowledged. So thank you so much for this call. It's now my pleasure to turn the floor over to Danitza. Danitza is an indigenous youth from Peru. She's representing the organization Oramia, and she will be presenting in Spanish. Danitza, please.
Gracias David, te agradezco a Guía por permitirme estar aquí presente, también a un organismo.
organización. Recibamos un saludo fraterno a nombre de los 55 pueblos indígenas originarios y también traigo las voces sobre la participación de las jóvenes indígenas, ¿no?, en la recopilación de datos y la implementación de proyectos como parte de la licencia intergeneracional entre las jóvenes y las mayoras dentro de las comunidades. Y para ello es importante partir primero, ¿por qué es importante el navegador indígena para los pueblos indígenas, para las jóvenes indígenas? Realmente, como me han antecedido, el navegador indígena es una herramienta fundamental para que los estados pues, puedan trabajar de acuerdo al diagnóstico real de las comunidades, las demandas, las necesidades que realmente necesitan ser solucionados por parte de los estados a través de las políticas públicas. Y también el cuestionario del navegador indígena, pues también ha fortalecido la gobernanza, la autonomía de las comunidades indígenas, en la que me consta su participación activa de las jóvenes, mayores y adultos, pues quienes han participado y también han respondido las preguntas de forma colectiva. Algunas preguntas del cuestionario no tenían términos técnicos, pero la juventud tenía el acceso de cierta manera a la tecnología, por lo que esto ha ayudado para que las hermanas y hermanos mayores puedan entender. Si bien es cierto, en el Perú existen 47 idiomas originarios, entonces es importante también que estas preguntas lleguen a las comunidades, a los territorios, ¿no?, en idioma para que pueda realizarse un verdadero diagnóstico y nuestras autoridades puedan garantizar nuestros derechos. También a la comunidad nos ha permitido planificar nuestro horizonte, nuestro plan de vida, porque en muchas comunidades no tenemos esa claridad, pero sin embargo con el cuestionario ha sido una herramienta fundamental para fortalecer nuestra gobernanza. ¿Y cómo a partir del navegador indígena podemos fortalecer los derechos de la libre determinación, autonomía, derechos constitucionales y las constituciones propias? Pues el navegador nos ha permitido evaluar también nuestras instituciones propias, como son la directiva, los diferentes comités que existen dentro de la comunidad y sobre todo fortalecer nuestra libre determinación, nuestra autonomía, conocer nuestros derechos. Cuando nosotras hemos participado en la comunidad para responder a las preguntas, ¿no?, del cuestionario del navegador indígena, pues nos hemos encontrado que la gran mayoría desconoce de sus derechos fundamentales como pueblos indígenas originarios. Entonces, por eso es importante, ¿no?, que este navegador informe y también esté al acceso de otras instituciones cuál es nuestra realidad de nuestras comunidades, de nuestros pueblos originarios, porque nuestros gobiernos lamentablemente mencionan estadísticamente que estamos en una estabilidad económica, social, pero sin embargo cuando a través de estas preguntas pues nos damos cuenta que no tenemos esa autonomía, esa libre determinación a la que nosotros los pueblos indígenas quisiéramos que garanticen, ¿no?, nuestras autoridades. ¿Y cómo han participado los jóvenes en la recopilación de esta información? Nuestras autoridades comunales generalmente convocan asambleas, así como ahora, y ahí hemos trabajado colectivamente y hemos llenado las preguntas, hemos respondido colectivamente, en la que la juventud ha participado activamente, ¿no? Esto también con ese objetivo de fortalecer la gobernanza, la autonomía de nuestras comunidades. Y los problemas y amenazas que enfrentamos principalmente en el Perú, pues desde la juventud hemos podido, ¿no?, evaluar a través de estas preguntas claves que están dentro del cuestionario del navegador indígena, pues realmente estamos en una situación donde no se garantizan nuestros derechos colectivos. Más al contrario, nos encontramos en un estado donde pues
vulneran nuestros derechos, donde no hay la seguridad territorial, y esto trae consecuencias, como la pérdida de nuestra identidad. Muchas veces, actualmente, se está aprobando leyes, la ley antiforestal, la ley del Comité de Autodefensa, en la que nuestro gobierno da más poder, más autoridad a otras instituciones, o sea, que no son propias del pueblo originario, traen una consecuencia como el despojo territorial, la pérdida de nuestra identidad originaria, nos desconectan de nuestra madre naturaleza y también, lamentablemente, nos enfrentamos a, bueno, recibimos, ¿no?, las jóvenes, la niñez, una educación, una salud colonial. Y lo que, ¿no?, desde mi experiencia en este cuestionario del navegador indígena, pues, a manera de resumir, no se respetan en general los derechos de los pueblos indígenas originarios, ¿no?, el derecho a la autonomía, libre determinación. Más bien, se promueven leyes que no son consultadas. Cuando los pueblos indígenas tenemos el derecho principalmente a la consulta previa. Nosotras como jóvenes hemos visto que la problemática generalmente es a causa de que no se garantiza la consulta previa, que no respeta nuestra libre determinación, nuestras propias formas de organizarnos dentro de la comunidad, y por ello es, sentimos que no hay desigualdad de derecho, no hay justicia para nuestros hermanos, hermanas, ¿no?, quienes en estos últimos años han luchado. Hay jóvenes también que están detenidas injustamente, y realmente esto nos preocupa. El derecho a la libre determinación, a la autonomía y derecho consuetudinario es cuando se va a garantizar realmente nuestra identidad cultural, el derecho a la consulta y consentimiento previo, libre, informado, el derecho a nuestra tierra, a nuestro territorio. Y también, ¿no?, nosotras necesitamos que dentro de los pueblos indígenas existan universidades indígenas para no perder esa identidad y continuar con nuestra lucha histórica. También necesitamos la salud y educación intercultural, y sobre todo que se garantice nuestro derecho constitucional, el acceso a la justicia. Y también necesitamos que se creen espacios donde involucren a la juventud indígena, porque lamentablemente a los pueblos indígenas nos ponen a un lado, no garantizan este derecho fundamental, como vuelvo a decir, el derecho a la consulta previa, la participación política de los pueblos indígenas. Y desde nuestra organización, también el navegador indígena nos ha permitido fortalecer a nuestras bases organizacionales, porque honestamente en el Estado ya no tenemos. Entonces, ¿qué tenemos que hacer? Es fortalecernos entre nosotros, porque tenemos que continuar con esta lucha histórica de defender a nuestro territorio, a nuestra madre naturaleza. Entonces, para ello es importante, como al inicio mencionaba, que la mayoría desconoce de los derechos fundamentales. Entonces, llegamos a las organizaciones a través de capacitaciones para fortalecer los derechos individuales y colectivos de los pueblos indígenas. También se han realizado plataformas regionales en regiones del Perú. Y por otro lado, desde nuestras comunidades siempre tenemos como historia practicar la siembra y cosecha de agua, conocer los hitos de nuestro territorio que llamamos liderazgo comunal. También continuamos anualmente con las forestaciones de plantas nativas. Y por parte de nuestra organización se producen publicaciones, boletines, cartillas, ¿no?, siempre con la posición firme de defender los derechos colectivos de las mujeres, jóvenes y pueblos indígenas. Y es importante también continuar este aprendizaje en estos espacios, ya sea a nivel local, provincial o nacional e internacional, pues hacer las réplicas a través de medios de programas radiales. Nosotras hemos identificado que es un instrumento importante, porque
porque en las comunidades no hay televisión, no hay internet, pero sí de alguna manera llegan las radios comunitarias. Por eso es importante también, importantes invitados que se encuentran en la sala puedan apostar también por garantizar que nuestra participación sea a través de los programas radiales y podamos llegar a, hasta lo más extremo de nuestras comunidades. Y los aportes, desafíos que enfrentamos actualmente es, puede que el Estado incorpore, ¿no?, nuestros saberes, nuestra cosmovisión y sobre todo nuestras prácticas ancestrales dentro de sus políticas públicas, pero sin apropiarse ni mercantilizarlo. Entonces, por eso es importante garantizar la participación plena y efectiva de las jóvenes, las mujeres y los pueblos indígenas en todo espacio de decisión. ¿Qué exigimos las jóvenes, los pueblos indígenas? La libre determinación, que es un derecho realmente persistente a la creación del Estado. Queremos una madre naturaleza, que es más valiosa que el dinero. Muchas gracias.
Thank you so much, Denitsa, for this very powerful presentation and for sharing the experience that you've had in this intergenerational transfer of knowledge and the role of youth not only in supporting elders and adapting to changing times, but also in engaging with such difficult contexts as the international human rights system, but also the sensitization in the communities of the rights that they have inherently, these fundamental rights, and what that means and how they can be used. We're very grateful for your intervention. With that, I would like to turn to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Jacinta Viali from SRBC in Guyana. Jacinta is from Shaltan village, located in the Wapichan territory of the South Rupuni area of Guyana. She's currently working with the South Rupuni District Council, which consists of 21 indigenous villages. I'll turn to you, please, for your presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, David. So the South Rupuni District Council established a pioneer program in November 2023 to provide technical support and advice to communities. The intention is to have the paralegals be a link between the SRDC, governmental agencies, and communities of the 21 villages, which are part of the SRDC. In 2020, the paralegal team benefited from a training on the introduction of the Indigenous Navigator Project, which saw representatives from an Indigenous organization from Suriname visiting Guyana to share their experiences on how they have conducted the survey and the positive impacts which came as a result of the survey. Learning about the Indigenous Navigator Survey and the experiences in other indigenous communities, I personally felt that it would be a great tool that would use, that we can use to monitor and identify issues or gaps that need addressing in these communities. The results of this survey would allow us to measure to what level the UN Drift is implementing in the communities, and it can help us to advocate of our rights to the government, UN bodies, and others. The SRDC shared my views and recognized that the Indigenous Navigator as an important tool to monitor the level of recognition and implementation of the rights of the Indigenous peoples in the Washington Territory. The paralegal team included women, men, elders, and youth. Three groups were formed by the paralegals to embark on the survey during the period of August and September 2023 by holding meetings in communities. They conducted the Indigenous Navigator Survey in 12 of the 21 communities of the Washington Territory. A simplified version of the survey was used throughout the process and translated into the Washington language by the paralegals so that the persons can understand the question that was being asked. So I was part of the paralegal team, and along with my fellow paralegals, we encountered several challenges while surveying the communities. Some of the main challenges came from the fact that the communities did not have data on some areas, especially in the section of health. However, in other areas, the communities were able to answer the questions, and this opened up for discussions, especially when it came to the section on self-determination, land, territories, and resources. The information gathered from survey carried out in the 12 villages was noted down by the paralegals. A day one session was held for the paralegals to learn the process of uploading the information. There were a few challenges encountered during this process, but the main problem was the lack of proper internet bandwidth. Despite the challenge, all information gathered was successfully uploaded to the online portal, which gave results and highlighted the gaps of Wakhtan peoples. The Wakhtan peoples are facing in our respective communities within the Wakhtan region. The results of the Indigenous Navigator was presented to the leaders at an extraordinary meeting of the SRDC in January 2024. The extraordinary meeting was held to discuss important issues and plans since there will be election of new leaders taking place in May 2024. During the presentations of the data gathered, the leaders learned of gaps and issues that need addressing in the Wakhtan territory. Based on the findings from the 12 communities, quality data was generated, which highlighted areas that need addressing, including the right to self-determination and education, among others. I'll highlight a few of the results from the survey, which scored the highest and the lowest. In cross-border contact, we scored high because those that live along the border would cross over to visit relatives. There is no physical border or any sort of checkpoint security at the border, so cross-border contact was easy. However, in self-determination and education sections, the score was very low. We continue to have challenges in exercising our right to self-determination. Wakhtan villages feel our right to self-determination is not being respected. Our rights to self-determination and to our land have been continuously violated, since we still do not have legal recognition to all of our customary lands. While there are provisions in the Amerindian Act that allow the right to self-government, it also gives the minister the authority to make final decisions in most cases. Further, there is a lack of opportunities and funds for tertiary education, and little use of the Wakhtan language at all levels of education. Another component of the Indigenous Navigator is the availability of small grants that would support the implementation of a priority project to enhance the rights of Indigenous peoples. Based on the findings, education was prioritized at the extraordinary meeting of the SRDC to help improve bilingual education in the Wakhtan region. The goal of this project is to ensure that young people in secondary schools can read, write, and speak the Wakhtan language. The Wakhtan classes will be held in 18 villages for students of the secondary schools to have young people to know, read, write, and speak the language fluently. This contributes to the preservation of the language in the South Kunene. Another aspect of this was to give students in secondary school information about various opportunities available for them after graduating. Therefore, a career day will be organized in two secondary schools in the Wakhtan territory, and it is expected that they will be attended by representatives from schools, from the different schools. In 2007, many countries, including Guyana, adopted the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. UNDRIP reaffirmed many rights that we have as Indigenous peoples and the obligations that government have to respect, protect, and fulfill these rights. However, Indigenous peoples' rights are still ignored all over the world. This Indigenous Navigator Survey helped us have a systematic way of gathering data from our communities to document how our communities feel about the implementation of their rights. We used this data in our shadow report to the Human Rights Committee earlier this year, and we saw that the committee made some strong recommendations to our government to improve respect for our rights. We also use the data to help us decide on priority areas for some funding. We hope that we can also use do the others say they respect our rights, our people at the community level are still experiencing rights violations. We hope that the government will see this data and work to respect and fulfill our rights as indigenous people. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jacinta, for sharing this experience and particularly for giving this insight not only to what the data can be used for in terms of advocacy and within the community itself, but also about how it can inform the development of these critical projects that are led by the community members themselves, identified by the community members themselves, and that address your priorities directly. It's fantastic to hear. I'm sorry that we're almost out of time, but I'd like to end with giving the floor to Vicky Kali-Corpus, who is an Indigenous human rights defender from the Philippines and former U.S. Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and is representing Tepeba as well, one of the consortium members of the Indigenous Navigator. Thank you so much, Vicky.
Thank you very much, Vicky. And thank you to all the panelists. You indeed have contributed a very concrete impact of the use of the Navigator. When we were still thinking about the Navigator, even ourselves, we were quite, it wasn't so clear to us how we will be able to use this, but the most important principle for us was the community participation in terms of generating the data, because we think that if the community is involved in generating the data, that will not just allow them to gather the data, but it will also make them understand what the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples is, no? Because most of the questions are related to how these rights are being implemented. So if most of the people haven't heard of it, the surveys that they need to do, they have to understand it better. And when we finally talk with them, and as we can hear, as we have heard, many of them said that they learn more about what is the UN Declaration and what needs to be done to implement it better, no? So I think that's the first thing. Second one, of course, is the innovations that the indigenous people need while doing this. I mean, like what they said in terms of translating it into languages, into the languages that can be understood, simplifying the questionnaires, because the questionnaires are a little bit complicated. But because of their own efforts, they were able to show that. No? So I think those who are really that kind of participation is crucial, no, for the success of the Navigator work. And of course, I know we are short of time. I just like to end with saying that, you know, the Navigator really is a tool that we look into the present, no? What is happening and what are the realities of indigenous peoples. But it also looks into the past, no? Like for example, Malé was saying that they looked into the institutions and then realized these institutions have existed for centuries. And these are the institutions that they have to fight for. Then of course, it looks into the future. As I was mentioned by our friends, they use this to develop their life plans, know, their strategies for advocacy, as well as identifying what are the priorities that they should advocate for with the states, with other donors, and of course other actors as well. So it's really a tool that looks into this whole cycle, you know, of lives of indigenous peoples, identifying what are the key issues, key priorities, but also identifying the visions that indigenous peoples would like to pursue, so that in the end they will be able to the intergenerational transmission is of course key to all of these. You know that I'm so happy to hear the involvement of the youth. You know, and that is where a lot of innovativeness comes in, because they are the ones who know the technologies that will allow for more visibility of the information and also to spread it even wider. So I think these are some of the points that we have heard, and I hope that with this, we'll be able to, of course, generate more support for this. We'll be able to expand beyond 30 countries and 300 communities, and the people have done it, the exchange of stories and experiences, as well as the lesson, will also help enrich all this work. Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all of you.